Samudra Shakti Online is brought to you by a planning team, which includes Maduri Martin, who's out west in the Colorado Rocky Mountains, and myself, Lisa Long, who is on the East Coast of the United States. I want to tell you a little bit about our planning committee for Samudra Shakti and how it began. So Deb Payne, myself, Maduri Martin, and Kim Friedman were part of the planning team that created the live event in the Colorado Rocky Mountains called Samudra Shakti. And that was in 2019. It was such an incredible event with so much energy that we wanted to continue it. And so we created Samudra Shakti Online. And I'm happy to report that in fall 2023, we will be returning to Estes Park, Colorado for another live event. So I hope you'll put it on your calendar. Tonight, we have Kat McCarthy with us, and she is presenting The Art and Science of Getting Along. Now, who does not need this topic? I mean, if you don't, you already have ascended and are awesome. But for most of us, like living the householder life, we need to know how to get along and some tools in our toolbox. And one of the things that Kat offers is this concept of what's called compassionate communication. And Kat McCarthy meets people where they are and supports them to where they want to go. She holds space which others can safely explore the heart, mind, body terrain, integrating the practice of yoga and the empathy skills of nonviolent communication. She's a dedicated student and an international trainer. Kat holds certifications in Anusara yoga, Kripalu yoga, and as well as nonviolent communication facilitation. She has studied extensively within the traditions of Rajanika yoga, Nilankantha meditation, and BMC's Embody Anatomy, and is currently with Dr. Gabor Mate's Compassionate Inquiry. Kat offers entertaining education with vulnerable humor and dynamic clarity, as well as compassionate presence, so that all humans can live a more aware and amazing life. When not traveling the globe to teach yoga, this Emmy-nominated filmmaker directs and produces nonfiction projects. Tonight, Kat McCarthy is with us, and I'm gonna stop my screen share and welcome Kat. Thank you, Kat, for joining us tonight.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, wow, that sounds really cool. I hope I can live up to what that presentation there. Yeah, so this is a very rich topic, and I know we only have a very short period of time and window to explore this, and usually I teach trainings that are very involved. So what I thought I would do is kind of contextualize what this work is and how I came to do it, because I'm always interested in the process that we go through, particularly applying yoga off the mat. The poses are easy compared to how to really keep that awareness very much in the forefront as we're interacting with people. Hang on, let me just put my thing on silent. There we go. Sorry. This is life, Zoom. Like, it's so funny, the boundaries of like work and life, everything sort of, and it's actually a really great practice of yoga. And if you can keep your sense of humor throughout all, you're doing really, really well. So, what I thought I would do is just sort of give you an amuse-bouche, if you will. I'm from New Orleans, so I talk about food often, so I'm just going to put that out there. A little taste of a very, very deep practice, and it's so interconnected with the yoga practice that we already do. It's just amazing that it hasn't been presented before. So when I first started practicing compassionate communication, which is based on the teachings of Marshall Rosenberg and nonviolent communication, it just seemed like a complete, yeah, of course, this is exactly what we're doing. We're just doing it. We're doing physical, mental, and emotional asana integrated. So my background, as Lisa explained, is as a filmmaker. And so I so value communication, and it's my favorite way to connect with people. And so I wanted to tell you a little bit about how I came to this whole, I don't even know what you call it. I guess it's a practice, another practice of yoga. But the thing is that's so interesting is that it's a very helpful tool for teachers, particularly in our school and in the role of being a yoga teacher. But most of all, it's about being a human and learning how to track where I go and how I'm interacting with people and how I'm interpreting what's being said. And it's actually been such a wonderful practice of remaining in a place of curiosity. Adbhuta in Sanskrit, right? This wonder of like, wow, I just got triggered. What is that? As opposed to the immediate, I got triggered and here we go, right? So I thought I would give you a little bit of an overview of what this is. And if you have any questions at any time, please just put them in the chat or interrupt me. I'm really not very formal about these things. But the main thing I wanted to sort of contextualize how this all came to be, part of it was that I was in the Anusara school, the old school, back in the day. And not to go into all of that history, but I would say that conflict resolution was not a strong point. We weren't necessarily knowledgeable of how to navigate that. And we had quite an implosion. And in all of that, I took it upon myself to become more equipped with handling conflict and handling ways to have difficult conversations. I also wanted to be a better partner in my marriage. And I'm a little bit of a, my addiction is learning. I just always want to learn more and more and more. And I thought, well, if I had more tools of learning how to communicate, then I'd be in a better position as a partner, right? And so these were things that kind of propelled me to jump into this particular approach. So I'm going to show you Marshall's book. This is an older version of it. It's called Nonviolent Communication, A Language for Life. And essentially, it is learning a new language, another way to speak, another way to hear. And just like when you learn a new language, you cannot expect to be fluent overnight. In fact, you have to learn the grammar. You have to learn all these steps in order for it to be something that becomes integrated. So it's not that you're doing it. You are living it. You are being it. And that takes time, as we know, right? It's not like meditation all of a sudden, you know, you do it one day and you've got it down. It gets deeper and deeper and deeper, right? You don't do handstand in the middle of the room first time unsupported. I mean, maybe some people do, but it's something that we kind of have to build, right, up to. And I really wanted to communicate better with my partner. And in doing this particular practice, it became very clear to me that my marriage wasn't working. And so, yeah, I was like, this is not why I joined this whole thing. And I'm certainly not saying that in learning this, your relationships will fall apart. In fact, they will get stronger, whether it's in intimate relationships or family or kids and parents and cohorts at work. But I will say that I had a good marriage, but I had a great divorce. And the reason why I had a great divorce is because I had tools with which to be present and loving and supportive and communicative during the transition and stay connected during the disconnection. And to me, that is key because how we end things determines the next beginning, as far as I'm concerned. And I know a lot of people who went through divorces and there's still toxicity in their systems with it, right? So I did it in a very clean way. And I have to say, I got that from my practice of compassionate communication. So Marshall Rosenberg was, I guess, in touch with one of Gandhi's grandsons, Arun, and created this modality called nonviolent communication. It is a global network. It is from countries at war that he would work with to people in families, to the educational system. in all sorts of contexts. It's a very simple approach. It's just not easy because it goes against years and years and years of being conditioned another way to look at the world. So it gives one lens to look at how we can navigate being human and in relationship, right, with people in the world. And it's not the only way. It's not the best way. It just happens to be one extremely effective way that has been so in keeping and so coalescing with what I've done within my studies of Anusara for all these years and understanding from a tantrika perspective of how to live, as Lisa said, as householders in the world. How do we pay our bills? How do we deal with the realities of day to day and navigate our outer terrain? But then how do we do that in our inner terrain? Because there's so much going on inside that I can't even like sometimes deal with what's going outside because I'm so interested and intrigued with what's you know happening inside. So I wanted to first show you how this came to be named Nonviolent Communication. I personally don't like the name because it kind of doesn't really represent what it is because it's really compassionate communication. But I will show you as I share the screen. This is probably an image you're very familiar with in the yoga world of the eight limbs of yoga. We have yamas, niyamas, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, and we go from the most outward going more and more inward. So the most external to become the most internal as we move towards samadhi with meditation, right? So from the gross to the subtle. The first of the yamas is ahimsa. And you probably have heard the word. It is one of the most basic fundamental things that we practice in the yoga world, and that is nonviolence, no intention to harm. So this book could have been called Ahimsa Communication, but Ahimsa Communication didn't have quite the cachet, and people would be like, what? So I think they just stuck with nonviolent communication. But I don't really care for that so much because it really is about cultivating compassion and getting our empathy muscles identified, strong, toned, takes practice. It's best done in community because it's like trying to give yourself a haircut. If I'm unsupervised and I'm trying to do like, you know, self-compassion, you know, I'm going to end up with my 80s asymmetrical haircut, right? So the whole point is that we do this in community because often we don't necessarily see things, our blind spots. They're called blind spots for a reason, right? So when we have community and we can get those muscles stronger in relationship, it's amazing how it has changed my relationship with myself. But that was not why I wanted to do it. I wanted to be a better communicator. I just happen to now be so much nicer to myself. And oh my gosh, it is great. I don't beat myself up the way I used to. And I'm really, really good at it. I've been doing it for years. So one of the things that yoga for me is about it, and particularly this approach that we study and practice in Anusara is about choice. We don't not have choice. We always have choice. So can we have many choices? Instead of it always being the one way of doing something. So the term samskara, which is the groove, the default that we fall into, to me plays in a pivotal role in being able to help me anchor some routine, something that's familiar over and over and over, right? Like you brush your teeth with one hand, try with the other hand just for the fun of it. See what happens. You'll be like, that's a different neural pathway. Very different, right? But the samskara is that we do this because it helps us. The question is, can we have many samskaras? Can we have many pathways, right? And so the whole point of this practice is having choice. Aha, that's where I could go. I choose to do it another way. But not because I should, but because it's gonna maybe create more connection and more understanding rather than the reaction that sometimes creates less connection. And I'm including that less connection to myself, right? So one of the things that I think is, okay, so I'm the resilience team leader for the compassionate, the community of resiliency, the compassionate communication here at Anusara. So I came back to the fold with all this new great stuff that I've added in to my training, because I am studying with Gabor Mate, if anyone's familiar with him. He teaches a trauma-informed, somatic-based type of therapy. And I have also studied a lot of polyvagal and how we have neuroception and perception, which is different. One is the body is perceiving or sensing safety versus, you know, it's, so I've done a lot of different things since I've been going rogue on my own. But I bring all this stuff back because it is so at the heart of this practice of Anusara, at least of what I know it to be. And I know we can all have different sort of perceptions of things, but I love the fact that even just within the UPAs, the Universal Principles of Alignment, there's spanda, pulsation, right? Nimesha unmesha. Everything is pulsation. There's vibration. It's also, the word spanda, actually, I was looking it up. It's derived from the root spandi, which means to move a little. I think of spanda also as like spandex. It has, you know, you can reach it. It goes back in. But it's also translated to mean movement, motion, vibration, and also creative pulsation, right? So, you know, what we do in poses, asana practice, is we're putting ourselves in different perspectives, different angles, viewing the world from different ways. And so NVC, or the compassionate communication that is based on, that I practice and I teach, is about being able to put ourselves in different poses, different perspectives to see. And then that way, when we have many different perspectives, we can then choose, aha, at this time, it's going to be more interesting from this way. What if I looked at it from this way? Because what happens, I know for myself, is it's like, it has to be this way. I'm so used to it being this way. And if it's not this way, then what am I going to do? That's a zero-sum game. So when I am curious about something, I expand. I'm like, wow, what is that? Let me learn more, right? And open to grace, which is the first of the principles, is all about expansion. It's all about starting in that very broad way, because we're in a contracted form physically, and we can easily get contracted mentally and emotionally. And there's nothing wrong with the contraction. It's actually really helpful, but you have to have the balance of the expansion, right? And the word tantra, right, is that we're stretching, but we're also weaving. There's this like creating connection as well as this stretching, right? So everything is a paradox. And that's one of the things that I love about this particular approach to yoga, is that it's this and that. It's not this or that. It's all of it. So there is a quote that's in the book, and it's also on the website, and I'll show you this in just a moment, which is from Rumi. And I never understood this quote until I started practicing compassionate communication. And the quote is, out beyond the ideas of right doing and wrong doing, there is a field. I will meet you there. And I was like, okay, that sounds like a great place. You know, can I get my mail forwarded there? Right? It is the essence of the practice, which is outside good, bad, right, wrong, should, shouldn't thinking. It's beyond that. And you may be like, well, what is that exactly? So the premise of compassionate communication, the biggest mantra of it, is that everything we do to meet a need. Everything. It's really, really simple. And I'm not going to present the map of everything tonight, because it's way more involved than the time that we have for it. But there is the theory of the practice and the practice of the practice. So I'm going to kind of present some ideas that are in the theory, because when we go into the practice and start doing this, it really is carving out new neural pathways. And that's what's really exciting. Everything we do to meet a need. So you're here tonight, perhaps. Oh, thank you, Midori. You're here to perhaps to learn more, right? So it's meeting a need, maybe for community, right? We're in community. Perhaps it's for learning, right? And you teach yoga. Maybe it meets a lot of needs. You love contribution. Again, maybe it's fun. Maybe it's again with learning, who knows, right? Maybe you sing or you dance and that's a form of self-expression. It meets a need for doing that, right? But why might I raise my voice and be upset with someone? What need is being met for that? So it's not just the sunshine and lollipop stuff, it's everything, right? If somebody hits someone else, it's meeting a need. And if you can look at the world through a needs-based consciousness, it changes it. It shifts the focus to something else. And what this does, this practice, is it changes the channel to something else. And when I'm able, and then it brings me to that field, right? I grew up in right, wrong, good, bad, should, shouldn't. Oh my God, I'm so well versed in that world. I mean, I feel like I've mastered it, right? So one of the things that I think is really helpful in this particular practice is that there are two ways that we can get into our needs. One is through feelings and anchoring our feelings into what is the need that is being expressed through whatever feeling we're having. And then the other is to translate our judgments to the embedded gem of a need that's inside of that. And the reason why I love this is because I am so good at judging. I am not going to stop because we have viveka, discernment. We want to be good at judging, right? How many yoga mats can fit in that space? That's a judgment, right? Don't touch the hot stove, a judgment, right? Do you like tea or coffee? It's a judgment. But the main judgments that we're talking about here is it, do we project that it's good and bad? Do we say that it's right and wrong? Should it be happening? Should it not be happening? That's a judgment. So when we translate the judgments, we get to needs. And all of a sudden, it's like, wow, these muscles of judging that I have toned for all these years in my life, I can use them to focus on something else. And that to me was very exciting because I don't want to have the yoga police outside my door saying, I'm sorry, that wasn't yogic, right? Whatever it is, like I don't want to be punitive about anything. I just want to be able to translate and excavate and get down into what is really going on. Because when people have conflict, they're really not, the conflict is on a very superficial level. It's not necessarily getting to what's happening underneath. So the way we get our needs met is through strategies. Right? So you came on to this thing to hear about this. It's a strategy for learning. People go to yoga class. It's a strategy for maybe self-connection, maybe movement, right? Maybe it's community. And so what happens often though is that people are arguing over strategies and not the needs that are being trying to get met. And often our strategies and our needs are so intertwined, they're so connected that if I don't get that strategy met, it's as if I'm not going to get the need met. And in our body, it might feel like I might not survive in this moment. So that is part of the practice that I think is so interesting, is to be able to start to extricate these things apart and be like, ah, here's the need, here's my strategy. To be able to have that awareness. Also, it's a really great practice of not taking anything personally. Easier said than done. I'm just going to say easier said than done, right? The yoga practice, in some cases for me, my experience is that I've become even more sensitive. I was told I was very sensitive as a child. You're too sensitive. I heard that my whole life. But I've become even more sensitive because I'm very sensitized. I am very aware of how my actions impact other people. Right? Yoga is skill in action. We're taking all these skills and putting it into practice, right? But it's so easy to take things personally and to hear things through a lens of some belief system that I'm just getting more ammunition to to add to my why I suck, my why I suck campaign, right? So all of this is such a great, highly entertaining practice to see what it is that I do and realize that I have a choice. But if I don't have another water-worthy boat to get into, I'm maybe gonna go on the sinking ship until I have something that I can sort of hang my hat on. So this practice gives me those tools, that practice, the experience to do things another way. And it has taken me, I'm gonna be honest with you, it's taken me years for empathy to be my go-to. I am so good at the things that are non-empathic because they are ways to try to connect, like advising, right? Giving advice. it's trying to contribute. But I now, if anyone wants advice, I want them to put it in an email and have it notarized in a letter and send it to me before I do it. Because I realize people necessarily don't want advice, but that is a way to connect, right? So when I practice empathy and when I'm able to do NVs, the empathy exchange that we actually practice within in compassion communication, it's a different muscle. It's a new muscle that needs to be worked out. So I can go to the empathy gym and get really strong and buff in my empathy muscles. So I've been practicing yoga for about, oh gosh, I don't know, almost 30 years. I don't know, time flies by. It keeps getting quicker as I get older, my relationship to time, right? And I've studied with various teachers philosophically for maybe 25 years. And applying the yoga off the mat was kind of like this huge gap for me. It's like I practice this philosophy, I love it, I weave it in, we put it in theming, all this stuff, but then how do you put it into your life? And there was a big gap for me. So this was the bridge. This is what helped me get there, so that my internal and my external landscapes are connected, as opposed to one and then the other, right? And I would say that I'm able to now live in both the internal and external worlds, which is kind of what we're doing, right? When we go into meditation, we're in a very internal place, but it's not to then do that and then forget about the outer world. We want to actually be able to return back, go grocery shopping, right, in the external world. But how to keep that sense of self-connection that maybe comes through various practices that we do. And that's where adaptability comes into play, and accountability. These are two things that I think are really... Adaptability might be more happening, right? We adapted during the pandemic. We've kind of figured it out. We kind of found a way through, right? But the accountability piece, I think, is kind of missing right now. And I live in New York City, and it's a very self-expressed place. There's a lot of self-expression met on the streets. And I love that, right? You know where you stand with certain people. The issue is that there's a projection of fear, there's a projection of anger, there's projection that's happening on each other because there is no, let's just say, there's not many places where we learn how to self-regulate, how we learn about ourselves. But luckily with the yoga practice, we get to be curious about what goes on inside. And I think it's very hard. We talk about being present. It's very hard to be present with what's happening when we're so focused on what should be happening, right? And whenever I say should, it's like I change it to choose, because this field, right, beyond right, wrong, good, bad, should, and thinking, this is what connects us as humans. So our needs are our values. They're the things that motivate our behavior, right? But I was motivated growing up to be a good girl, to do the right thing, because that's what you should do. So I've had all the cultural conditioning, which has gotten me very far in life. It has. But I don't necessarily think that's the only way. So I want to share a quote with you. But are there any questions before I jump in? Because I realize that this is going to hopefully be more of a Q&A and ask questions, because we don't really have time to go into anything as substantial as I normally would, having a longer thing. Any questions in the chat, Maduri, before I go on? Okay. All right. So there's an Austrian neurologist and psychiatrist named Viktor Frankl, who's also a Holocaust survivor. And his quote is, "Between stimulus and response, there is a space. In that space, there is freedom to choose. In our response lies our growth and our freedom." I'll read that again. "Between stimulus and response, there is a space. In that space, there is freedom to choose. In our response lies our growth and our freedom." Because we talk a lot about the concept of freedom in yoga, and everyone can have different definitions of that. But what he speaks to, and what I'm going to show you on this next screen share, is something from one of my teachers about what we're kind of doing in this practice, because it's a practice of slowing down. When things move so quickly, like if I'm going on the highway, I don't see things very much because I'm just like moving through life. But when you break down on the highway, it's amazing the things you'll notice, right? Because you're like stuck. You're like maybe walking to go get help. You see more, right? When we slow things down, we have the capacity to maybe not gloss over something. We have to kind of contend with what is. So I'm going to share this with you. This is from my teacher, who unfortunately passed away last year. He's a wonderful, wonderful person. Hang on just a second. His name is Robert Gonzalez. Okay, let's see. Hang on just a moment. I'm becoming slowly better at the Zoom thing, but not always. Okay, here we go. Okay. So this is a good visualization. I'm a visual learner, so I kind of like to have charts and things. It just kind of grounds me a little better. So we have a life event. Something stimulates us. Something triggers us. Something, right? And you probably know when you get triggered, because there's like, you know, your face changes, you know, you kind of have this like, whatever it is that happens. But we know when something happens, something is said, we notice something, an event that occurs, whatnot. So when we have a stimulus, there is this straight into thinking body where there's a judgment or an evaluation, right? This is wrong. This is not good. This should not be happening, right? Then we also have a reactive feeling, which is in the emotional realm, right? We might have fear or anger, or feel overwhelmed or confused or anxiety, or something come up in the emotional body. And then physically, we have sensation in our physical body. There's tension, there's constriction, there's contraction, right? So when either of these things show up, that's a really good indication that something is up. Now, if this happens so quickly, and I know this happens for me, it's rapid fire. It's like someone litters, I go straight into judgment. Or I see someone walking on the street with their dog and they're on their phone and the dog's trying to go to the bathroom and they're pulling them along, and I just go into, why do you have a dog? What's wrong with you? You know, I go into all that judgment. Now, I don't say it out loud to anyone because that's not going to create connection nor help the issue, but at least I'm aware. Oh, okay. Something is happening inside of me right now. Now, what we are doing in this practice is we are in the space before this goes into our regularly scheduled programming, the samskaras that we have, right? We go into this place of awareness. This is the space. This is where the choice happens. When I slow things down, I can choose and I can respond as opposed to the reaction, which is judgment, anger. There's something going on. My body is like already ready for the attack or ready for whatever. So the practice of compassionate communication is learning to live in this place, slowing it down by focusing on what is my need, what is going on right now, by feeling the feelings and attaching them to what is grounding that. And I'm not going to get too much into that, but I just want to sort of take my word for it. How about? And then the judgment. If there is judgment, what is that telling me about what I value that I'm not experiencing right now? If there is the fear or the anger or whatever it is, that is telling me something about myself. And then if the body gets into that constricted place, right, with spanda, it's like drawing in, then that is telling me something. And these are all great ways to get into our bodies, the mental, emotional, and physical body. All right, let me stop share for just a moment. I want to show one more thing, if I may. So on the Anusara website, we have this whole brilliantly created page that was done before I came on the scene. So I'm just so appreciative that it's here, and I'm going to share it with you here. Let's see if I can find it. Here we go. Okay. Right. So on the Anusara website, there is the community resilience, right? And it goes into, here's the Rumi quote. Oh, how nice. Goes into the framework, explains all this, goes, downloads this guide, right? So I'm now going to download it. I'm going to show you what the guide looks like. Now, realize that all this is just a map. Practicing it is a totally different thing. It's like, you know, the menu of a restaurant is telling you what the meal is going to be, but the meal, your experience is going to be your own, right? But at least don't confuse the menu with the meal, right? Okay, so this is the framework. This was created by Kim, Tiffany, W.J. Payne, and this was training that they did with a nonviolent communication teacher named John Kenyon, which was really great. I'm so happy that this was done. This was all done completely separately from my own path. So the fact that we get to join forces is just solid. Okay, so the overview of this practice of compassionate communication, there's a krama, there's a sequence, is that we go through stages of observations, feelings, needs, to then go to requests. And this is just kind of the big picture. It's called OFNR, O-F-N-R, on the street, you know, in case you're wanting to have some street cred with your compassion buddies, right? So it's learning to look at things as an observer rather than an evaluator, to be able to know the difference between you slammed the door in my face to the door happened to shut right before I was walking through it. Right? That's a different thing, right? There's observations, and that's part of the practice that we do. Then it's learning to expand our feelings, not just happy, sad, good, I feel okay, I'm tired, I feel angry. It goes into, are you miffed or are you outraged? Like, there's different spectrums of what we experience. Are you sad and kind of weepy, or are you just completely devastated? I mean, they're different words that express our emotional realms. Then we get into needs, which is getting into the difference between needs and wants. Wants are strategies. Like, I want chocolate. Yeah, I totally want chocolate. But what is that? What need does it meet? Stimulation. Right? Beauty, whatever it is. But like being able to realize that the things that we need is what we all share as sentient beings. I need you to do the dishes is not a need, but it sounds like one, right? So it's learning like how we use our language, you know, like, I feel like you're being a jerk. That's not a feeling, but it sounds like one. So it's learning what our languaging is around things and how we actually embed a lot of our words with judgments and with assumptions. And then we get into requests, and requests are action requests. And then which is asking someone to do something on your behalf as a request, not a demand, or a connection request, being able to have conversations about very difficult things that, again, slowing it down. And these are things that we practice. Also here has some basic feelings and needs. I have my own chart that I work with, but this is kind of nice that we have feelings that are associated with needs being met or not being met. Notice it's not saying it's a good feeling, it's a bad feeling, it's a right feeling, it's a wrong feeling, right? It has to do with if our needs are being met to the degree to which we want them met. And that's a whole other, this is, I realize, a little bit of a jargon of it, but it's very helpful to look at it that way. And then our human needs, right? We, you know, from being able to have like food and water and shelter, which isn't on here, but those are things that are on the list that I have, to like, you know, independence, creativity, love, belonging, like things that we all can understand. So that if you're having an argument with someone, if you look at what's the need being met, I can totally understand where someone is coming from and why they might be motivated to do a particular behavior. But it does not mean that I agree with that behavior. It's a very different thing to understand versus to agree, right? So they have this whole framework of the observations, feelings, needs, and requests. And the reason why you have to kind of go through this sequence is because when you go through and break things down and unpack them and get a lot of clarity, the requests on the very end are very different than when you first are like, I need you to do the dishes, right? Very, very different. So we go through the process, we go through all that. I just wanted to show you that this is a whole fabulous thing that's available to you on the website. Just wanted to point that out because it's very nicely put together. Okay, I just talked a lot, and I'm curious if there are any questions or thoughts or anything based on what I've shared. I do have something that we could maybe do, you know, but I think for the matter of time, I'd like to know where people are, where they are with all this. If anyone's familiar with compassionate communication, if you've done any training like this before, I'd like to open it up.
Kat, I just
well,
like
we,
to say,
go ahead, Lisa.
You go first.
Well, I was just going to read to you what was happening in the chat while you were discussing.
Oh, thank you.
And Lisa brought up this question about slowing down. Like, how do we slow down to appreciate the space that turns us between, you know, stimulus and response? Do you have any suggestions for that?
Molasses. I think being aware that I'm moving very quickly and I'm going, I mean, if someone says something and it's like, I mean, family, oh my goodness, right? You think you're enlightened and then you go home and visit family and all the buttons are pushed and everything is like, right? So that's a great practice to go and visit your family and see if you can not take anything personally. But in lieu of that, I would say that it's being aware, first of all, that I've gotten triggered. I just got triggered. Something stimulated me. Now I want to be really clear about what I mean by trigger, because if you have a gun and there's a trigger in the gun, the trigger is not the ammunition, it's not the explosion, but it's the facilitation, it's the stimulus that you have, that ammunition inside of you. So anytime I get triggered, it is not about the other person. They just happen to stimulate something that is already in me, that probably has been in me for a long time. And they just happen to know, they just happen to be the stimulus for it. So when I get triggered, it's an opportunity for me to say, and this comes up all the time, what is that? Not like I just got triggered and I'm now gonna straight back say something that I don't mean. but more like, wow, something's going on inside. And I almost have to press the pause button and be like, what is that? As my body contracted, have I just noticed that something happened in my body, right? Is there an emotional realm component that just came up? Like, am I hurt? Am I angry? Am I confused, right? Then the judgment, right? It's so quick. I'm so good at judging. It's not gonna stop. But I can notice, wow, I'm judging right now. That's helpful. That slows it down, right? So if I can be accountable for what goes on for me, I'm gonna be so busy trying to unpack what's happening for me that I won't even be bothered by the other person because there's so much rich stuff that I can figure out inside. But I'd say the awareness that I'm going straight into some sort of old patterning is one way to slow it down. It takes practice. I don't know if anyone else has any suggestions. I'd love to hear because it's taken me some time. But
The good old count to 10, you know.
Yeah, take a few breaths, right?
Yeah.
But I think the biggest thing that for me, because I can judge myself for being judgmental, right? And so I'm just kind of staying in this place, this judgment sphere. And instead, can I translate that and be like, wow, I am really, really, really needing contribution right now, and it is just not happening, or consideration right now, and it's just not happening. And we go, in this practice, we also talk about what grieving and mourning is, right? And being able to stay focused on the needs and to be able to appreciate a need even if it's not being met, but knowing that we still value it, right? Mm-hmm. So it's actually a practice of tracking where I am at any given moment. Mm-hmm. That is fascinating, and that slows me down. People will trigger us. That's we live in relationship. That's not a problem. The issue is, what do I do with it? How can this be an opportunity to learn something more about myself? So I can say, thank you so much for triggering me. Oh my gosh, I got so much out of it. I've learned so much. And if we do it in community, it's a lovely way to have backup. Unsupervised, I can get into all sorts of mishigas on my own. It's been so wonderful interacting with my family in a different way that it has changed the way we interact. It has nothing to do with them doing anything. I'm just not saying the script that they're expecting me to say. I've changed it, and then it's a little disruptive for a while, but then modeling it is really the strongest way to teach anyway, you know, to like actually live it as opposed to say, well, just do what I say, not what I do, right? Well, thank you very much for inviting me to come on and share something that I'm very passionate about. Yes, thank you.